Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, I am so glad to be able to speak next to Mr. Bialatski, because that means at least him is already at large. But is he a free person just because he can travel here? Let me first raise the issue of political prisoners in its larger meaning. What does it mean that people, either by amnesty at the will of the president or simply because they have sit out the term, go free, if the very moment they get into the category I should take it off. Yes, sir. So the point is, the very moment they may get free, they get into the category that Alice mentioned, the tunejatstvo, meaning they are parasites. Getting some people free, some political prisoners free, is meaningless if there is no rehabilitation of the status, which means simply dropping the criminal status. And this is only one category of the kind of mirage of improvement of the situation. I have to tell you, and I will soon report it to the Geneva Human Rights Council of the United Nations, that the human rights situation, far from improving, has deteriorated if you measure it by the regulations, by the quality of life, by the possibilities of civil society to act. In particular, the media situation has grossly deteriorated. The Belarus system is, just like for 20 years it has done, is a laboratory of new bureaucratic hurdles, how to this time how to re-territorialize control over the global medium, internet, and it is very successful. It goes over to another regulatory field, namely to freedom of association, of assembly, and anything that is done in public. In Belarus, every day almost, the notion of what is public activity, what is public presence on the streets, gets wider and wider and gets punished if it is done without any permission. Absolutely unchanged is the brand Belarus invention of the triple trap for any public activity, be it association, be it assembly, be it media. Every activity needs permission. Practically no activity gets permission, which is not by the liking of the authorities. And the third layer, the third trap, is that it is criminal not only to organize something that has not been permitted, but it is criminal to simply participate. So Mr. Bialatski is at large, is out of prison because of the clemency of the president, because Vyasna, his large, absolutely important human rights organization, did not get the registration. So he, leading that organization, by definition, is a criminal. So if he is with us today, then it is only because the president has not yet issued the order to put him behind bars again. Which leads me, actually, to the legal system, to the jurisdiction over the country and to the issue of parliament. The president is, for 20 years now, has been the absolute ruler of the country. Nominally, Belarus has a parliament, but the country is governed by presidential decrees. There are two types of jurisdiction of the president. One is given by the constitution, the other is given by two-thirds of parliament, and these two jurisdictions cover absolutely everything. And there is no escape from this. This is the only parliament in Europe which for 20 years now has not had any kind of opposition. It's a totally opposition-free parliament, on the top of it, every time the president gets elected, there is mass violence on the streets. So the situation has not improved socially either, even if the myth that the system is spreading about itself is that it's a social, almost welfare system. This is not the case. It is very much a forced labor-driven, forced labor-fueled economy, 70-80% state-owned, which, as we, all of us who have lived under communism, remember the kind of fake stability or fake security that a totally state-owned economic system gives the citizens. But in Belarus, this is, of course, as fragile as the president's powers are if you look behind it and if you look for the economic fundamentals. I believe if this is the situation, and because of the geopolitical situation, you have seen an improvement of Belarus's status as a mediating country in the Ukrainian crisis. What you may face as a problem is the danger of a two-tracked policy vis-à-vis Belarus. That on the one hand, you would have this deteriorating, in fact, human rights situation with political prisoners, their number sometimes raising, sometimes in ebb, but still there. And the regulatory system is not changing at all, and democracy and pluralism, the situation of them is not changing at all. And on the other hand, you have this quite feverish diplomatic activity and improvement of the situation with the government. I believe that the European Parliament could contribute to connect somehow, to tie up somehow these two presently very separate fields. I believe that conditionality that Chair has mentioned has to be taken seriously. We all have to be gradualists. Of course, there is no overnight improvement, but a measure of gradualism has to be introduced into the relationships with Belarus. Otherwise, what we are landing at is nothing but giving support to the very special, very oppressive notion of security, of stability, of the regime itself. The danger is that we would end up by subscribing to President Lukashenko's everyday warnings that, okay, on the one hand, we oppose annexations, we don't like infringement on the territorial integrity of European countries, but on the other hand, no Maidan. And if you translate that warning, no done into real terms, that you, what you see is this superbly oppressive and well-crafted system of oppression, the calmness and stability of absolutely no possibility for civil society to exercise their human rights and their democratic rights. As others alluded to it, the system of President Lukashenko needs Europe right now. It really needs Europe now. Even as the Union, the Eurasian Economic Union, into which Belarus has, which Belarus has become a member of, is there, but the crisis, the economic crisis of Russia, precludes that the usual support, the usual subsidies that make the system go on could continue. My political ego, my political side tells me that that gives a leverage, that does produce a leverage for Europe, for the part of Europe, for the politicians of Europe that crave to see an improvement of the political situation. As a very last point, let me mention my own mandate, somewhat chauvinistically. Stubbornly, the officials maintain that they would not acknowledge this mandate. I believe that that's a symbolic issue. That means, or that reveals, that tells about the ability and the willingness of the system to cooperate with the international human rights system. So it is not only because, in order for me to be more efficient, hopefully even more efficient than I am, I need a visa and I need to enter the territory of Belarus. But also for the seriousness of the international human rights system and for taking seriously the pledges of the regime that they would like to cooperate with you, I believe it is absolutely necessary to tell them that this mandate, in the creation of which Europe and the delegations in Geneva of Europe have been very influential, this mandate is not going away only by cooperation from Belarus with this mandate. This message is urgent, and I would thank you if you help convey this message to Minsk. Thank you so much for your interest.